I was saying thank you to Steve, thank you to Henry, and all of you people coming here. It's a pleasure to be here. This is my fourth year, so I'm once again happy to be here. And the fourth, this is the fourth year for the conference, so I'm becoming a mainstay, I think. I wanted to share with you some things. The title that they asked me to speak about is Implications, Not Applications, and the Single Paradigm. And so I'm going to narrow in on that particular theme and that particular topic. It's one of my favorite ones, but also one that I hope you'll find some value and meaning from. The principles establish something that's really never been clearly established before in human history, and that is that in order to have a psychological experience, there have to be three principles, no more than three, involved. They are the synchronon. They're the simple, absolute truths of the nature of psychological life or mental life. So mental life has three principles necessary for it. And these three principles create a paradigm. They create a logic. They create a simplicity and an accuracy that we've never had before. So that's what I wanted to talk about and pass on and go into some depth with in order to be to satisfy my speaking requirements. I would like to say, I'd like to say a few things that will kind of lead us into the right direction of the conversation, but that one statement I just made, that without the three principles, there's no possibility of human psychological mental life. If you take that assumption and hear me out, I think there might be some things that will become clearer for you. So I wanted to say some other things. These powers, these principles, are not self-created. They're not good ideas or things that are somebody's theory. They're not concepts or beliefs. They're actual deep, profound truths that are unusurpable. They're fact. And because of that, they are of a different order than we've ever had before to understand ourselves and understand our mental life according to. Even in psychology, there's never been a paradigm or principles throughout psychological science. That's never been true. It is now true. So we have something to stand on and something to communicate and something to help some profound, deep organization that's been uncovered. One of the things that Sid Banks talked about often was he didn't discover these, he uncovered them. And he wouldn't talk about them as if they were his or if he held any ownership over them. He talked about them with tremendous amount of depth and wisdom, but also great and profound humility. And you'll see that in anyone who gets a comprehension of the principles. There's always a sense of gratitude and humility and that kind of perspective on it. It's not a thing that you do or own or create. It's a thing that's been shown to us as a people. And because of that, that's not an unimportant attitude or an unimportant way that people talk about the principles. There'll always be that sense of grace and humility about it. One of the things that Sid Banks said, I got a couple things up here, I just thought I'd read them or reflect on them together with you. He said, I'm not talking about your, in terms of thought, mind, thought, and consciousness, in terms of thought, he said, I'm not talking about your thought or my thought. He says, I'm talking about the universal power called thought. There are no components to thought. It is an element that can never be broken down into smaller segments. Everything on earth comes from one divine source. Our personal thoughts determine what we think of the form that is taken in our lives. So the what that we think about, and we objectify it, and we think the what of our thinking, but the that of it, he would often say that, I'm not talking about what you think, I'm talking about that you think. So that's the commonality, that's the simplicity, that's the profundity of a universal principle of that unifies all of us. Another thing he said was that you've been putting ideas into the power of thought since the day you were born. And as Dr. Pettit mentioned this morning, no two people think alike, but that's in terms of the what of we all think. That we all think is the universal fact of thought. Thought is a spiritual power, but on its own, it really has no power. Thought itself is completely neutral. It is not until you put your ideas into that power or that thought gets its power. Whatever you put into that thought, whether it be negative or positive or whatever, it will manifest itself into actual experience. All feelings, and when he says feelings here, he would mean all feeling states, all states of mind, all moods, all positive feelings, negative feelings, experiences, attitudes. That's one way that a lot of guys that I've worked with through the years, I would talk about feelings and say, I just don't have feelings. I said, well, you have attitude? Oh yeah, I definitely have attitude, you know. So they identify with these different words when we say feelings, but all feelings, all experiences, all realities, all states of mind, they all, whether positive or negative, come alive from the power of thought. Everything comes via a feeling, and a feeling comes via thought. It's all connected. You can't get away from it. Again, the secret lies in thought. What is the difference between thought and feeling? Thought is neutral. A feeling is a reaction from thought. You have a bad feeling, but it's still a reaction from thought. You have a good feeling, but it's still a reaction from thought. Thought is a divine tool and the link between you and your divine inheritance. The power of thought is the missing link that allows us to recognize the illusory, and I'm going to underline, illusory separation between the spiritual world and the world of form. That those two worlds are the same. We can think of them separately, but thought allows us to see that they're not separate. And it's that unification of the world, the spiritual world, and the world of form that many of us all relate to. That's probably one of the reasons why many of you are here. You've heard something about that that's spoken to you and made sense to you in a profound way, that there's no separation. And that theme of no separation is an important one in what I wanted to say today. All sicknesses of the mind are created through time via thought. The secret of all psychology is manifested in thought. And one other thing that he said about mental sicknesses, because as Dr. Pettit pointed out this morning, there really isn't any difference in mental sicknesses. We've all suffered mental sicknesses and do again and again and again. He gave the definition of how mental sicknesses happen and how they disappear in two sentences. The first was about mental sickness. The second is about mental health. He said, mental sicknesses are created when we put feelings onto objects. Now that object could be anything. Could be people, could be the past, it could be events, could be circumstances, it could be situations, could be relationships, could be your husband, your children, your father, could be yourself. You can objectify yourself and put feelings onto yourself about you and create a little mental sickness or a big mental sickness. That's the first sentence. Second sentence, but if you can see the objects without the feeling, then you're healthy. So these moments of understanding and moments of truth, moments of letting go of something or reconciling yourself with the truth of life, which we've all had. There have been many, many things that we had feelings about. We put feelings onto objects throughout our lives. And at some point, we stop doing that. We let it go. We see something happens. It could be an insight. It's always going to be an insight. An insight, another thing that Citibank said that was really profound for me, he said, an insight is when your ego collapses on a particular subject. So when you see something that you have identified, objectified, and put feelings onto, which we've all done, anyone in here hasn't done that? I won't even ask you to raise your hand, because even if you raise your hand, I know you wouldn't understand what I'm saying, or you would never raise your hand. If you ever put feelings onto objects, events, circumstances, situations, people, yourself, and the deception of yourself creates ego, and we all know that's the biggest problem anybody's got. When you do that, you break with logic. There's an illogic is formulated right there that looks like your feeling is not coming from thought in the moment, but it looks like it's coming from that object. So you can be, you hear people saying this all the time. Valda has a story she tells, for example, occurs to me. She says she's driving down the highway going to Seattle from where we live in Laconia, Washington. She's driving, and all of a sudden she gets, Valda's my wife, all of a sudden she gets this tremendous sense of anxiety and apprehension, and she doesn't know where it came from. So she looks out in front of her thinking there must be something serious happening on the highway coming her way. She sees nothing. She quickly looks in the rearview mirror, sees nothing. Side mirrors, nothing, nothing. She thinks maybe the car is going to explode. She looks at her gauges. What's up with her? The tires. What's the feel of the road? Anything that would determine where this feeling was coming from. Nothing. Then it occurs to her, as something you'll hear me say often if we talk or think, work together, where do you think your feelings are coming from? It's a simple but very profound statement that will alert you to the truth of whether your feelings are based in the principles in the moment, or the thought, or your thought in the moment, or are they based somewhere else? Well, the answer to that question is always the same. The answer is, it has to be based in your thought in the moment. Your feelings are based in your thought in the moment. That's true for everybody, everywhere, birth to death. Now, when she asked herself that question, She knew the answer to it. It had to be thought in the moment. And then her next thought was, well, what was I thinking? How could I have thought such a disturbing, anxious thought, a more anxious feeling than she had ever felt in her life? Nothing. She had no understanding, still doesn't to this day. It happened 10 years ago. She has, and who knows what you think about on a 70-mile drive down the highway, right, by yourself? You're thinking is going all over the place a lot of the times. She knew that she had to have a thought that created that feeling. It didn't matter to her what the thought was, because it's not about what you think. That feeling came from thought, the power and the gift of thought. However used in the moment, whatever you think about in the moment is not the point. The point is it has a power and it generates a feeling. So what we've learned to do, we saw a kind of a line in the sand, a sort of, is our mental life determined by our use of these principles in the moment, or isn't it? Now the answer again is always that it is, but sometimes it helps you to really take stock and see, does this feeling I'm in right now, whatever feeling you're in, now or later or tomorrow, or 5 years ago, 5 years from now, or whatever, it has to do with your use of these principles in the moment. The truth of that will do something to show you how it works and how it doesn't work. So something gets revealed, something gets realized for you that will bring you back to the truth of it. It doesn't happen any other way. There's no other way for you to have a feeling, have an experience, have mental life itself without these principles being involved. That will restore you, and it will subside your mental illnesses caused by ego that creates that separation, and it will pull you back to reality. So there's a reality and a logic about the way we all function, and sometimes we forget. When we forget, we can forget for a minute, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 5 years. There's no time limit on how long a person can go outside in, what I call outside in, outside the logic and wisdom of how these principles work. But the truth is, relief, restoration, resilience is immediately available moment to moment to moment. So we've had a lot of different insights about this and cures. And anytime there's a story told about the changes that someone has undergone with the principles or even otherwise, even in other therapies, let's say, or other instances of spontaneous remission, or people changing, or they're seeing something about themselves they'd never seen before, and it really helped them. Several people have come up to me since I've been here telling me stories like that. They're all instances of a moment of truth wherein people saw that the feeling they were feeling was coming from the thinking they were thinking. It wasn't coming from anywhere else. And that simple truth helps them and makes them resilient. So I wanted to say that now. And then I want to go into, how are we doing on time? Okay. So Svi's got some. So let's just go through some specifics about this that might further drive the point home. So I have some what I call implications not applications, that I prepared. And again, inside out is, it, when it says inside out, it doesn't mean inside the body or inside yourself. Innate health is not inside yourself. It's inside the logic and wisdom of how the principles work. And outside the wisdom and logic of how the principles work is outside. So I'm drawing a very black and white line here between inside out and outside in. And every one of these will be arranged so such that you could reflect on it. So I want to read these together with you, because we found too, just listening and soaking them in and seeing the relevance of this, of the principles, it might help you see the relevance of the principles for you more deeply than what you had previously thought. Inside out. So a definition of, we're just using these are popular terms, flat earth thinking, meaning there was a time on the earth, people didn't know the earth was round, maybe 2,500 years ago. They realized it was. Until then, the world was captivated by the threat of going over the edge. No longer true. No one ever thinks about that threat anymore that I know of. Now, we know it's round. We've seen it from space that it's round. And flat earth thinking has become obsolete. We believe that the thinking that we are now all vulnerable to and affected by, that we all suffer from time to time, some of us more, some of us less, some days more, some days less, of outside-in thinking could be revealed to us, insightfully revealed. It has to be an insight. You see it in the moment, you realize that you have a paradigm problem, not a thinking problem, not a level problem, not a right-wrong problem, not a good-bad problem, not a healthy thinking, unhealthy thinking problem. You lost your way because you thought the feeling you were feeling was not coming from the thinking you're thinking. You'll never have a feeling without thought and without your use of thought. It's impossible. So that the truth of that being the way, being a simple explanation of the human experience, it will draw a line in the sand for you, and there'll be thoughts that you'll naturally grow out of or naturally drop or naturally, the illogic of them will be revealed to you, and you will naturally become resilient every time. Inside out, flat earth thinking is what is rendered obsolete. I'm going to read these from here instead of craning my neck, I think. When we realize something is not true or even possible, it's not possible to so outside in, it's not possible to have an experience without mind, thought, and consciousness. It's not even possible to have mental life without mind, thought, and consciousness. These are the unifying principles between us and God. They are the God experience. When I was working on a book before Sid Banks passed away, we were working on a book that's yet to be released, and he said, well, you know what the principles are. And I didn't realize it was a rhetorical question. I kind of went into panic mode. I thought, oh my goodness, he's asking me what the principles are? He's been talking to me about the principles for 30 years. And I kind of froze. I was like a deer in the headlights. I sort of went. And then I realized it was a rhetorical question, because he says, God mind. Principles are God mind. And as soon as he said God mind, I thought, oh, yeah, right. You know, like, it was such a simple, profound answer that it really did something for me. It took a lot off my mind. Now, one of the things that we've seen from going over these implications and looking at them more specifically of the principles is the same effect as you could end your conversation after every one of these and ask, how much thinking would that take off your mind? How much thinking would that take off your mind? The when you see something that's true and it does something for your soul, your heart, and it quiets your mind. So there's an effect and an impact of quieting your mind. My mind has gotten so much quieter since I learned this as a paradigm that it's exposed a lot of flat earth thinking that I had about objects, people, experiences. It's exposed a lot of my own ego that I never knew I had. I didn't think I had much ego. Well, lo and behold, I have a lot of ego, and it gets shown to me regularly by understanding how the principles work and pressing myself against that. I get to learn a lot about myself, and it's really benefited me tremendously. So your mind is quieted through subtraction. So this is sort of a subtraction effect of the principles. This is, if we could, just think of it, if we could subtract all of the outside-in thinking out of all of your minds, let's say. Say you leave here, and for the rest of your life, there's a steady subtraction and a decrease of outside-in thinking. The quietude and the presence of mind and the effectiveness and the accuracy of your mental life would increase proportionally, because there's a lot of things that we think about that are not true, that aren't true. They're just ruminations and insecurities and doubts and fears and jealousies and envies and hates and all kinds of petty thinking that we don't even know where is eating up our mental lives. If a line gets drawn for you, that you see, when you see that you're outside in about those thoughts and those habits and those experiences, and it hits you that you're being illogical, it's a lot less tempting. It's a lot less tempting to keep thinking it. It loses its steam. It loses its, you get a lot less interested in pursuing it and holding it and ruminating on it and worrying about it. Outside in, we were fooled by flat earth thinking and innocently believe it to be true. This thinking preoccupies our mind and exponentially multiplies our thinking. So outside in a way you could say, you're thinking that your unnecessary, reactive, judgmental thinking has babies. And they multiply like, I don't know, like bunnies or rats or something like that. They have a way of just increasing and filling up your mind unnecessarily. Okay. Separate realities. So I just want to read these over just so to make sure everybody's tracking it. Inside out, we do not waste time being dismayed that others do not think like us. This puts us in the position to respect and embrace diversity rather than be annoyed or afraid of it. We understand, I actually cannot have your thoughts, and you actually cannot have mine. No one can think the same as anyone else. As much as I may think it would be better if you would think like me, it cannot happen. We find ourselves able to listen and communicate more and more effectively. Outside in, we believe in the outside in false paradigm. Separate realities are not obvious to us. When others do not think like us, we think there's either something wrong with them or us. This illusion creates unnecessary outside in thinking and reactions. We stay trapped in the illusion that we could or should think and feel the same. If you look really closely, it doesn't work that way. Everybody thinks differently and feels accordingly. It's about time that we got onto that and be able to see that in operation. It'll add a great deal of simplicity and quietude to your life. If you think it shouldn't be that way or you don't like it, it creates a lot of mental activity. Next one. The 100% solution. A lot of times people, if I ask in a group how many people, like if I said in here, how many of you think or believe that your feeling has something to do with your thinking, everybody raise their hand. Well, sure. I mean, you've noticed that. That fact hasn't eluded you. But if I go to lunch with you or we become friends, I'll start to notice, or you may notice it about me too, that I'll have feelings that don't look like they're caused by my thinking. So the problem isn't so much that we don't have the principles already true, but the problem is we're about 80%. You know, I have a good colleague of mine. She came over to our house. She says, I got to tell you, I don't know what's going on here, but I want to talk to you guys because I can see that you have a 100% thing going on about where your feelings are coming from. And she says, I don't really have 100%. She says, I've got holdouts. She says, I can see that there are places where I don't think my feelings are coming from my thinking. And I want to know why it's 100%. And I said, well, look, it's a principle. And a principle doesn't quit. It's not like it takes a day off or something. That's the way it is. And if you can reconcile yourself with the way it is, there'll be a lot of things that, like it was becoming revealed to her. Gee, all here and here and here and here. I don't really think my feelings are coming from my thinking there. I think they're coming from that guy. I think they're coming from how he acted, what he does. I think they're coming from this place and that place and the other place. And she says, I don't want to have any more holdouts. I want to go 100%. I want to learn about that. If I could learn about that, I know, I have a feeling it would really help me because I'm starting to think those places where I've got holdouts are where all my problems are. She says, a lot of places I do fine, but there are places, things and people and events and situations and circumstances, it just gets my goat. And she said, I don't want my goat to get got anymore. I'm kind of done with that. But I want to learn something. I want to get some help on that. I want to go 100%. This is a paradigm of no exceptions. Feelings are 100% of the time coming from our thinking in the moment. If we are thinking it, we are feeling it. If thought in the moment is not included, we will not have a psychological experience. I just want to say that again. If thought in the moment is not included, we cannot have a psychological experience. Understanding this one psychological truth automatically quiets our thinking and aligns us with the paradigm of the three principles. The experience of this truth acts as a doorway to deeper thoughts and feelings. The definitive black and white distinction between thought in the moment included or thought in the moment not included brings simplicity to life. Outside in, some measure less than 100% immediately creates the illusion of a second or false paradigm. This suggests we can have experience without thought in the moment included. This adds a never-ending number of possible causes for our feelings. If a paradigm worked this way, it would necessarily be full of exceptions and anomalies. You know, in science, when there's a principle discovered, and again, we've never had principles in psychology until Sidney Banks. When there's a principle discovered, it's one of the defining characteristics. There's three defining characteristics. One is it's a constant. It doesn't vary. It doesn't quit. It's always true. The second criteria is that there's no exceptions or anomalies. There's nothing that isn't true to the principle. And thirdly, it's predictive. If you have a principle, it creates a predictability. There's things that fold out from that logic that are inevitable. Not because by your own hand, it's not that you're making it predictive or you're making it constant or you're making it without exceptions. That's built into the paradigm. It's already there. You don't have to make that happen. It's already done. And when you can get realigned with how it's already done, you're going to get more mentally healthy, guaranteed. Complexity and a busier mind are an inevitable outcome of this one single misunderstanding. Okay, next. How are we doing on time? Oh, pretty good. Well, actually not so good, but I'll carry on a little faster. The future is an incomplete equation. This helps a lot of people with worry. I have these on my desk. Sometimes I'll read them along with my clients that I'm coaching or different situations that I have. In thinking about the future, we know we do not have a complete equation. We know we do not know what thinking will come to us in the moment. We spend less time imagining future scenarios. This is not saying don't think about the future. It is saying that when we do think about the future, we know thinking in the moment will always be missing. This being reality, we are surprisingly unburdened. Things, the imposing scenarios of the future drop. Outside in, we think we have a complete equation when we think about the future. We imagine scenarios. Anybody ever do this? We imagine scenarios, create expectations, and spend time thinking about them as if they were true. So we suffer them. There's an old Irish saying, I've suffered many terrible things in my life, and most of them have never happened. There's a lot of truth to that. This detaches us from reality. Again, inside out is logical, outside in, illogical. If I said to any one of you, do you want to run your life according to an illogic? I don't think you'd say yes, because something that's logical is truthful. There's nothing to fear in logic. If there's something fearful in logic, then you don't understand. You've only got a partial piece of the truth of it. Logic is transcendental. It's powerful. We get disappointed, afraid, and upset when our imagined scenarios do not come true.
Okay,
let's do another one, Svi. Are these helpful? We can handle the truth. When we know our feelings are coming from thought in the moment, it eliminates other false possibilities. It narrows down to one moment in time, the present, where we consciously experience feeling as being created through thought. We experience no misunderstanding or separation between us and the logic and wisdom of the inside-out paradigm. We do not feel insecure. We can handle the truth. All the stories of resilience, people doing things that are remarkable or rising above, they face the truth, but they're not afraid of it. They handle it. No matter what comes their way, they're present to it. Outside in, we think something other than thought in the moment can make us feel in a way we do not want to do or do not want to feel. You can also have positive thinking, that where you try to get away from things and think positively, as Dr. Pettit mentioned earlier too. We inevitably feel insecure. We cannot handle the truth. We turn to wishful thinking, sticking our heads in the sand like an ostrich, or just repetitively thinking the same thing over and over. Okay, let's do another. Who's got the power? Inside out. When we understand the inside out psychological paradigm, we are not bound by the circumstance or the past. We are not saying the circumstance did not happen. We are saying the circumstance did happen, but it does not have the power to dictate how we will feel. The illusion is not the circumstance. The illusion is that the circumstance has the power to dictate how we will feel. Only thought in the moment can give us an experience of the circumstance, a feeling of the circumstance. Say again?
Talk a little bit more about the illusion.
So the illusion that we're pointing to here is that feeling is not coming through to you. Your feeling is not coming to you through your use of the principle of thought in the moment. You can get hurt feeling, you can get angry feeling, you can get jealous feeling. It looks like, again, those objects that you're thinking about, it looks like they're creating your feeling and you've got nothing to do with it. Not true. You have to have thought in the moment included for any feeling you have. So by understanding this as a paradigm, one of the things that started to happen is we put all feelings back together. We weren't trying to have some feelings and not have other feelings. We weren't trying to have some thinking and not have other thinking. We weren't trying to have, we were realizing that all feeling is thought. All feeling, positive and negative, are thought in the moment. And that was a very important, a different line to understand where feelings are coming from in the moment. It's not coming from anywhere other than your use of the power of thought in the moment. So it gives a black and white, simple discriminator about the truth of your own experience. Good, bad, or ugly, it's coming from to you through your use of the power of thought in the moment. It can't come any other way. When we believe in the outside in illusion, it appears as if the circumstances have the power to dictate how we feel. We seem to lose our psychological freedom and safety. We forget we are experiencing the power of thought in the moment. There's no other place to be. This one particularly helped a woman that was working in the earthquake in Nepal. As they went over this one, it stopped the crowd, and everyone wanted, that's all they wanted to talk about the rest of the day. There is one specific place and time we can experience thinking, creating, feeling. It is not in the past or the future. This only exists in the present moment. There's truth and insight in this present moment. Once we experience the value of this insight, we will find ourselves in the present moment more often. It is as if we finally have a practical reason to be there. I often wondered, how do I get into the present moment? Sid would always talk about the present moment, talk about the now in every talk he ever gave. And I considered it to be a good idea, but I didn't know how it might happen. But when I understood the principles as a paradigm, the subtraction kicked in. When the subtraction kicked in, I found myself. There's nowhere else to be but the present moment if you don't have thoughts to the contrary or misunderstanding to the contrary. So when that was taken away, the present moment became more and more where I found myself. When we are in the false outside-in misunderstanding, we get focused on and attached to something other than thought in the moment as the source of our feeling. We are preoccupied away from the present moment. We seem to lose our freedom and our resilience. Let's do the big takeaway. We could call this whole session the big takeaway. Inside out, as outside in misunderstanding, again, outside the wisdom and logic of the three principles paradigm, as outside in misunderstanding is seen for what it is, it naturally falls away. It'd be like you were a ship's captain and you had learned that the earth is round. Well, you could bring the lookout that's been posted up there since you've been sailing, looking out for the edge. You could say, you know, I've got other jobs I could have you do here on ship, because you don't have to be looking out for the edge anymore. It's not out there. It would take something off. It would be a subtraction of a threat that no longer is true. That could be done for all of our minds, or if it could be done for the minds of humanity. Do you have any idea what that would do for all of us? The kind of calm and presence and confidence, security, psychological safety, it would guarantee. It'd be incredible. And it's all based on one fundamental illusion. We find ourselves living in an inside-out world of deeper wisdom, where feelings of love, compassion, gratitude, quiet-mindedness, respect, humility, and an inner strength reside. These are not a list of things to try to accomplish. These happen to us when the outside-in thinking falls away, or the outside-in falls away, as logical or even possible. We will naturally live a more loving and better life. Outside in, we believe the false outside in explanation of where our feelings are coming from. We consider many different reasons for why we feel the way we do. Our minds work overtime and repetitively. We're looking for a resonant feeling that registers as true. And truth does not exist in the outside in. Shallow, fearful, insecure feelings are hallmarks of the outside-in misunderstanding of our life. Okay, one more. This is not an implication of the paradigm, but it's an observation. So these implications are very rigorous. We've kept specifically to the truth that feeling is coming from thought in the moment. But so that sometimes we see it and sometimes we don't isn't an implication of the paradigm, but it's a statement about each of us. We begin to catch sight of how deceptive the outside-in illusion really is. I expect that you'll be seeing it more. We see that we are sometimes fooled by it and sometimes not. Everyone gets fooled by this deception. In this way, we are all in the same boat. It becomes illogical to judge and criticize others because they lose sight of the inside out just like we do. In light of this understanding, compassion and humility emerge naturally without effort. We're capable of being honest about ourselves. We stop judging and we start listening and communicating. Outside in, we are fooled by the deception of the outside in and innocently forget to factor in thought in the moment as the source of feeling. It honestly seems as if what we are thinking about has the power to dictate how we are feeling. It does not. You can think about anything inside out or outside in. It's how you think, it's understanding that will show you your own power to think about anything. We do not purposely lose sight of the inside out paradigm. This has been the greatest deception since the beginning of time. The moment we lose sight of the inside out, we lose the chance to be honest with ourselves. Okay. I know my time is out. I'm probably over it, so. I love how quiet the room gets. It takes a lot off our minds, as I said, and I really value that. So here's to your life forward with less on your mind and more presence and more heart and soul in your experience. Thank you very much.
Thank you.